We may have, and some of my fellow legislators will be joining us soon with additional questions. So, Insha, thank you.
I want to apologize really quickly. Chloe, I didn't see you on the internet. Can you introduce Chloe, please? Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you so much for making time to be here in your busy schedules and to care as much as we do about the use of incarceration in jail in New York and specifically in your county. I get paid for a living to do this work. I love this work, but you all are coming here as people who are from Greene County, who really care about the decisions your county makes, and know that it really means a lot to us that you're taking time to hear from us. And so, Lori, with that amazing introduction, one thing I want to say is we're not really here to give guidance. Like, we don't know Greene County in the way that all of you all know Greene County. I want to make that very, very clear. So any things that we sort of say about Greene County that we know from our research or from talking to you folks that doesn't sound right, stop us. Let us know, because it's really important that we are working with the right information, accurate data, and that whatever we put out there is correct, because decisions, and this is perhaps one of the biggest decisions that Greene County has made in a long, long time, a capital construction project about whether or not to build a new jail, and that's a decision that literally generations of residents of Greene County will have to sort of, you know, bear the weight of, depending on which way that decision goes. And again, we're not here to weigh in on that decision. I'll be totally honest. The work I do is very much about how can we have perhaps fewer people in jail across New York State. You know, I was thinking about what to share with you all, and one thing that really occurred to me is something, you know, a criminal justice expert, Mike Green, who actually runs the State Division of Criminal Justice Services, he said, and he has been a county prosecutor, he has been the sort of chief criminal justice policy person for the state for many years, and he says, you know, about jails, if you build them, they will come. And what he means by that is, if you build a jail and if you have enough beds, they do get filled, because that's just the nature of what jail construction and making it sort of worth it. That's just what happens, and we've seen that happen again and again. And so that's really where I wanted to start, to just make that clear, that if Greene County makes a decision to have more beds available, chances are they will get filled. And the question that you all have to grapple with is that the right thing for Greene County? And so I want to do three things today, and I want this to be very informal. I want you to jump in and ask questions or raise a comment or a concern as I go through my presentation, but I have three things I want to make sure that we cover. For one, I want to sort of zoom out a little bit and talk about what are some examples of new jail construction or not constructing a new jail across the rest of the state that might be instructive for Greene County? In preparing for today, and Chloe, who is an intern with Vera this summer and has been doing a tremendous amount of work, literally combing through the minutes of every public safety committee meeting on this issue, reading about Greene County. We've read the Richie Green report from a couple of years ago. We have read the media coverage of what to do about the jail. It's really clear.
Since you're letting us jump in, what I wanted, yeah. Chloe made a timeline of mm-hmm. how this progressed, and all of us have participated in one way or another, and so we have these little pieces of the picture here, this, but that timeline turns out to be remarkably valuable. And so I'm grateful even for that aspect of the research. Just where were we? How did we get here? What did we do to do all of that?
Yeah.
That's a really important resource.
Yeah, absolutely. And the timeline that Scott is referring to is quite literally going through all of the documents that we've seen and sort of mapping out from about a decade ago how did the sort of concerns from the State Commission of Corrections about the existing Greene County Jail, how did those start to manifest? What was the correspondence with Sheriff Seeley? And what led to the decisions in April of this year to actually shutter the current facility. So if folks are interested, that is something we certainly can share with you all. It's a timeline we created essentially for ourselves to help educate us. We shared it with Lori and with a few others, and it sounds like it might be a helpful document for everyone. So anything that we have, the PowerPoint, any materials that we reference that you want to see, we're more than happy to share it. So as I said, I want to sort of zoom out and share some examples from other parts of the state, because We at VERA do a lot of work around the rest of the state as well as nationally and internationally to think about using incarceration just more judiciously and fairly and thoughtfully. And I want to hone in on some things that I think are opportunities for Greene County to consider, many of which you have already talked about and considered, but I think it's worth just sort of highlighting again, knowing what has worked in other places, what might be here for you to consider. And then third, I just want to touch upon some research we've done about shared services in a regional jail with Columbia County. We know that this has been a conversation that you all have already been having, and I just want to give you some of the research we've done about the feasibility of doing so here. So with no further ado, Lori already introduced VERA, but VERA is an organization that's existed since 1961. Our very first project was, in fact, in New York City, where our founder, Herb Sturz, realized that there were far too many people in jail in Manhattan in a jail called the Tombs, because quite literally it is like a jail cell that leads to people's deaths, right? And he realized lots of people were there who just were there because they couldn't afford bail. They were there because of their poverty or other circumstance, and they weren't actually a threat to public safety or a public safety risk. And so we got our start really working on bail and getting people out of jail. And then over the last 50 years, we have continued to do this kind of work, both around New York City, New York State, nationally, as well as internationally. And how I see our work is we really want to rethink the use of jails, not to say that there's never a place for them. Obviously, there is. But we can be much more thoughtful about who we put in jail and who we might want to consider treating elsewhere or doing something different than simply using jail. And so as Lori mentioned, we created a website last fall that if you haven't taken a look, it might just be interesting or instructive for you. But we basically mapped out what is the use of jail and incarceration across New York State. And there was a figure that really stood out to me as somebody who loves data and numbers and research, which is across New York State, there are 25,000 people in jail on any given day. And in fact, 3 out of 5 are in jail outside of New York City.
So jail and prison.
I'm just going to interject here. And Scott, this isn't directed at you. It's just because we're recording it. If we can hold off on questions until the end. I have some note cards, though, that I'll give. And it'll just make recording go more smoothly.
Understood, but you also suggested we jump in. And the issue is whether it's a prison or a jail.
Yep, so it's just jail.
25,000 in jail.
25,000 in New York State who are in jail. So county facilities like the Greene County Jail, Columbia County, Buffalo Jail, like those kinds of jails. If you want to know our prison numbers, there's about 52,000 New Yorkers in prison today. So across the board, jails and prisons, we have over 75,000 New Yorkers in jail and prison. 25,000 are specifically just in county jails. And it used to be that New York City was where most people were in jail in New York State. And that has changed tremendously, just literally in the past 15 years, where now, in fact, more people are in jail in the counties outside of New York City. And so why do I bring this up? Because what we are seeing is in New York City, there's been a lot of work done to sort of roll back mass incarceration, to think about using jail differently. And that same effort and those same resources and that same attention just hasn't been focused on upstate counties, on counties outside of New York City. And so that's the work that I do, is I work not only in New York City, but I am working right now with the Cortland County Legislature, who are at a decision essentially close to one that you are making about whether or not to build a new county facility. Likewise with Tompkins County, with a number of other counties across the state. And then nationally, we've worked in Oklahoma. Oklahoma City has done a lot of work to not build a new jail. And there are some other places similarly that we can bring up examples that we've learned in our work. And so this is important because one thing I want to point out is in Greene County, you've in fact experienced sort of no increase in crime. Crime has actually gone down in Greene County, and yet the use of jail has pretty much stayed the same over the past several years. And what it suggests is that even though there's less crime happening, you're using jail more. right? Or you're using jail in ways that feel like, well, there's perhaps some other alternative, something else you can consider. And so just to zoom out for a second, I want to talk about two counties in New York. The first one is Ulster County, our neighbor. Ulster County, back in 2007, built a new jail. And to the point of, if you build it, they will come, this is the jail incarceration rate in Ulster County over the last 15 years, from before 2000 to up to 2016. And what you can see is that Ulster County's jail incarceration rate, meaning the number of residents from Ulster County who are in jail per 100,000 residents, remains sort of below the statewide average, which is about 200 residents per 100,000, until about 2007, when Ulster County built the new jail that you know well, because some members of some Green residents are there right now since your current jail closed. And what you can see is, since that time, since 2007, the jail incarceration rate went up. It actually went above the state average. Again, the idea is, if you put beds online, they get filled. Ulster County made a decision in the past couple of years to decarcerate, to take less people. Some of that is that they are actually inboarding fewer inmates from other counties. But very much, if you look at just the county, that the number from Ulster County, that number has consistently gone up since they built a new, bigger jail. On the other hand, compare that to a place like Tompkins County, which is Ithaca and the surrounding towns and villages. And they have been confronting the idea of building a new jail for the last decade, and they have consistently made a decision to not build a new jail. Instead, what they've been choosing to do is to figure out, what can we do before we get to the point of incarceration? Can we do things differently with the police? Can we do things differently with the courts and how we're using bail to limit the number of people who are in jail in Tompkins County? And what you can see is their jail incarceration rate has always been below the statewide average, and in fact, it has consistently stayed essentially the same over time. And I posit that that's because they just haven't given themselves the margin to actually put more people in jail. They've had to be deliberate and careful and focused about how they address crime in their county. And so, again, the reason I bring this up is because it's a decision that you all can make, and it's a response that actors such as the police and the sheriff's office and judges, they can actually choose to do things differently. It's not simply a foregone conclusion that everybody ends up in jail. And so if you compare the two, you can see sort of more obviously what I'm talking about, Ulster County's increase in jail incarceration while Tompkins County has stayed essentially the same. And so just to put...
Could I interrupt?
Yeah,
I apologize because I'm also attending to space. So if you said this, the Ulster County increase in the incarceration rate post-construction of the jail, to be clear, was not commensurate with an increased crime rate at all.
No, nope,
I believe that
not.
There is sometimes a sense that, you know, that there's a direct correlation between those two, and I think your point was that, in fact, is not the case, and that was not the case in Ulster County, correct?
That's very true. So I will look to exact numbers for you, but I know from studying Ulster County that they had no uptick in crime. In fact, their crime rate has remained about the same over the last several years, but that increase that you saw was essentially... the same kinds of cases are coming through the courts, but now that since there's an option to put more people in jail, that was becoming the default response. I do a lot of training of judges, and I have asked judges who, over the same period of time, they sat on the bench for 20 years, and their own practices have shifted, and in part, it's a cultural expectation. If you know that your county jail is full, you'll think, let me think about pretrial services, let me think about a certain kind of bail that this person can make. Let me figure out, is this somebody I really need to put in jail? If there is no cap on that, if you're not forced to do that kind of consideration, judges, because they have very difficult jobs where, God forbid, they release somebody and that person goes out and does something, they're, you know, their names are in the paper, that's often what's front of mind for many judges. And so it's really about the community and the larger criminal justice system in a county, making sure that it's a joint responsibility, that we are okay with letting out certain people, and we're going to put in place the services, the resources, such as pretrial supervision, such as alternatives to incarceration, to make sure that people, when they are out in the community, in fact, are safe and productive.
I guess to that point, would it be, is it in your experience that if a county puts a lot of resources into beds and incarceration, they might be limited on what tools can be in the tool belt for their judges? And Ulster is a classic example, I guess, of what I think of with that.
Mm-hmm.
But is that, is it usually a limited resource type thing? You see a lot of that?
Yeah, I mean, what we see is when places are choosing to build more beds, it's at the expense of something else. Like, they are not adding more slots for pretrial supervision. They are adding more beds to the jail, right, or opening a new wing. I think it feels like a zero-sum game if there's limited resources, so we only sort of really put it to one thing. I've seen other counties, like Tompkins County, for example, decide we're not going to build new jails, we're not going to build a new wing, we're not going to build a new jail entirely, but we will really beef up on pretrial services, on educating our judges, on creating more treatment options as well. So that's exactly right.
But Ulster County has an active pretrial release program.
It does. Yep. And they still have a...
So there's no correlation between what they built and that program. They didn't cut that program down.
They did not cut that program. They also haven't expanded it, though. And what we have heard anecdotally, and I've spent a good amount of time in Ulster County, is that judges for the same cases that 10 years ago or 15 years ago before the jail was built, they might have considered release. Now they're just sort of defaulting to setting bail, that if people can't afford it, they're sitting in jail. So that's essentially what's happening.
What type of jail does Tompkins County have?
It has a smaller jail that's been around for, I want to say, maybe 4 or 5 decades.
So it's linear?
Yes, it's a linear jail. Yep, exactly. And they have gotten their jail population down to a place where they don't actually outboard anybody.
So they don't have any pods at all?
They don't, no. The direct supervision model, or a modified direct supervision model, which are the two that are sort of more in vogue, if you will, for building new jails, there's not that many examples of them in New York State. It's only the jails that have been built in the last 15 years or so that are built either in a pod model or like a modified podular structure.
There was a lot of controversy about the Ulster County Jail, and then there were a lot of lawsuits and grand juries, mm-hmm. and how big and why.
Yep.
And so after the process failed to stop it before it occurred, then there was this enormous amount of extra litigation that was going on. And what I'm hearing you say is because they built a certain size, they're filling it up.
So here's what's actually going on. Undo it
once it's done.
Yeah, I don't know if folks have been following the most recent sort of media coverage of the Ulster County Jail, but just a couple weeks ago there was a piece in the news about Ulster County, which is Dutchess County for the longest time was sending people to the Ulster County Jail since it was a bigger jail. They had open beds that weren't getting filled. And Dutchess County recently has taken on a number of steps, including sending less people to jail. And so they aren't renting out as many beds from Ulster County. And so right now, Ulster County actually has empty beds that still cost money to keep operational. They're still paying for the same number of corrections officers and staff, yet they're sort of running under capacity. And that's because they assumed in building a bigger jail that they would get inboarded inmates from other counties, and that is starting to happen less. So that's certainly something that's been in the news literally just a couple weeks ago as well.
Just point out also that when the slope was going up, it was under a Republican administration. Mm-hmm. As a result of the things you're talking about, it changed to a Democratic administration, and the line has started going down.
Yeah.
The headline last week was that Ulster's making money off of Green County, which was a little misleading. So we have to be very careful how the public relations is poised in the climate.
Yep. And I think one of the important things to consider as we're thinking about whether to build or not is just simple costs, right? There's the cost of construction, and then there's the cost of operations each year. And so what we know is Tompkins County last year spent $5.3 million on jail. And so that was on its jail, on staffing, on operations, on, you know, programming, medical care, all of the things that people who are incarcerated are entitled to. On the other hand, Ulster County, which incarcerates at twice the rate of Tompkins County, spent $22.3 million. That's simply in operations. That's aside from the cost of the construction of the jail. And so that's a very important thing to consider in terms of building a jail. Its size is what it would cost to run it and operate it each year. Lori.
So, and I'm sorry, I'm sensitive to you getting through what you want to talk about, but to that issue, and you mentioned before we had a quick conversation about direct versus indirect supervision, I think one, just for clarification, I think there's some confusion over the idea of a direct supervision, of what that actually means, and that that's just limited to a physical plant as opposed to a management style, and how that, in fact, would impact the cost for operations. So
research has shown us there are a handful of really excellent models of direct supervision jails across the country. I can tell you a couple that I have visited myself. One is in Alexandria, Virginia. It's one of the first direct supervision layouts. And what that literally means is, and I wish I had known that this was of interest because I'd bring pictures of what that looks like, but it is, there's in a pod, there is an open space in the middle of the pod that is for programming, for meals, for other sorts of services. And then around that open area are jail cells, and they can be just one floor of jail cells. I've seen jails in which there are two rows of jail cells. They can be single cells, they can be double cells, they can be shared cells. And the idea is, because it is built sort of in the round, you can have fewer officers supervising and overseeing that particular area. So it really is about the physical plant. And so the reason why you have fewer officers is because the officers can actually see all of the cells easily, as opposed to a traditional jail, which is built in that linear structure. So imagine sort of what you see on TV, right, where it's cell, 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 all the way down a row. And then in those kinds of plants, you have corrections officers stationed at, say, every sort of sixth cell or tenth cell to make sure that they're actually able to see. They have shorter sight lines, and so that's why the direct sort of pod structure has come into fashion and is the preferred way to build. It also lends a sense of community, right, that people have a shared space. It means people can see each other. There's actually sort of more supervision going on than in cells where all you see is the person in the cell across from you, but nobody else. And, you know, corrections officers can speak to this better than anybody else, but jails are not only for the people who are incarcerated there, but for the people who work there. And what has been seen from the research is that having a direct a pod layout actually fosters a sense of community and a better sort of like sense of camaraderie, and people enjoy working in jails that are in that layout more than others. And so one thing Greene County can do, and it's something that we, Vera, do all the time, is we take folks to other jails so that they can have an idea of what does this look like. There are other jails that are built, you know, sort of more efficiently, to use space better, that don't cost as much to operate, and we can certainly show you examples of that. Because if the county decides to build, I think there's a very real question about, like, how do you build, how big, all of those questions.
But
as
one,
well.
The most important part isn't necessarily how much staffing costs. If you have a prison or a jail, if you have a jail, it costs $52 million, and it's $89 million with interest. And then that's only the facility. And then you have the operating costs of the facility. And then you have the maintenance costs of the facility. And then you have the defense costs. So the genuine cost,
it's bigger than construction.
We're not really ever seeing the actual financials.
Yep.
And we didn't even see the plan until recently.
In the interest of time, because I want to make sure that there is time to get through some of the ideas and suggestions I have for you all about other things you might want to consider in terms of policing and in terms of courts as well. And so I just want to highlight a couple of key statistics that I think really matter for Greene County. One is, who do you have in jail that is there because they can't afford bail? Bail is being set that they're not making. And we know that about 50% of people held in Greene County's jail are held pretrial. And what that means is they haven't yet taken a plea or been convicted of a crime. They're not serving a sentence. They may have other kinds of warrants or violations, and we can look carefully at the data. I know that work has been done here to look at that. But it seems like there's a sizable chunk of folks who are in on bail they can't afford, where there's a question, at least for some of them, can we do business differently and at least have some of those folks not be in jail? Another statistic that I think is really important for who could potentially not be in jail are, we know 65% of people held in jail in Greene County are held on drug and property offenses or for a violation of probation. And the decision to violate somebody on probation is a court determination, and so there is discretion there that perhaps with some work with the judges here in Greene County, we can in fact get that number of people who are on what are called VOPs, bless you, violations of probation, that number can be reduced, as well as thinking about drug and property offenses, which not at all to minimize those kinds of offenses, but to just suggest those are the kinds of offenses that tend to correlate with either a behavioral health issue, like the need for drug treatment or the need for some sort of mental health consideration. That's a really significant number. That's literally almost 2 out of 3 people in the jail fit that category. And then the next thing I just want to share is, I mean, last year you spent $5.3 million in incarceration in either running the jail that you had here in Greene County or outboarding folks. And that is a pretty significant number, considering that this county is 50,000 people, and Tompkins County, which also spent about $5.3 million, is a county that is over twice the size of Greene County. It's 105,000 people. So potential solutions, what might you want to consider looking at? And I know a lot of these suggestions that I have are ideas that I know have been talked about here, have been considered. What I wanted to do was really highlight programs and services and opportunities that have worked in other parts of the state or in other parts of the country, so that, again, you can actually go and look at it, explore, and see how is it working in practice, and is this something you might be able to do here in Greene County. And so one is a program that I know there's been some mention of. It's called Law Enforcement Assisted Diversion. So at the moment of arrest, right now in Greene County, my understanding, and again, correct me if I'm wrong, but when a police officer comes across somebody who's being, say, disruptive or rowdy on the street, who clearly appears to be under the influence of drugs or alcohol, they have two choices. One is just to let that person go at risk to perhaps themselves or at risk to perhaps somebody else, or to put that person through the system where the likelihood is they're going to end up in jail. There's some other options out there. And one of the programs that has debuted to a lot of success in Albany, which is not far away, is Law Enforcement Assisted Diversion. And the former police chief of Albany, Chief Brandon Cox, was the person who brought this. It was really at the behest of the Albany Police Department, where their police officers were like, we would like some more options. Right now, we're just putting everybody into the jail. Give us another choice. And so what Law Enforcement Assisted Diversion is if a police officer comes across an incident where it appears, well, this is fairly low level, it is minor, there's nobody harmed or injured or no serious crime that's happened, but clearly something is going on. I can't just let this person go. What can I do instead? And in LEAD, what you can do is the police officer actually calls a case manager. There's always one or two case managers on call. They literally come to the scene. They do a short sort of crisis intervention with the person of like, what do you need right now? Is it, do we need to detox? Do you need some medication? Do you just need to sort of sober up? What is it? And then the requirement there is that that individual have at least one more case management follow-up with the case manager, and it's usually a nonprofit organization that is contracted with the county to do this work. And so long as the person makes that second case management appointment, They can, in fact, choose voluntarily to engage in, say, drug treatment or counseling or a job development program, or they can choose not to. But so long as a person meets those mandates, we know, first of all, that they're stabilized, right, in that instant, sort of that moment where otherwise the officer would have potentially made an arrest. And second, they're finally connected to services so that if they do want to engage, they have the opportunity, they've had sort of a warm interaction with somebody, and they know sort of where their office is, and they can go back. So what happens with the actual arrest? Nothing. The idea is that the district attorney is aware of that interaction. If the person doesn't make their second case management appointment, then the district attorney files the charges, as they would have anyway. But it's basically giving somebody a chance for an alternate disposition, and one where it actually responds to what perhaps are the underlying needs. And so you can go online to the LEAD program website. It's leadbureau.org, and you can look at their one-year anniversary report. It has some really fascinating statistics of how many people have been served on what kinds of charges and what have been the outcomes of those cases. And the sort of the punchline is it's been really good and really positive, and officers have had a really positive view of it as well. And it's a program that's right here. You can go visit, and I'm happy to connect anybody who's interested in doing that to Chief Cox, who is a great resource and can really speak so thoughtfully to this. Did you have a question?
You're talking about it's maybe a private jail, or it's belong to some person or the group, or what is, who's the owner of this jail?
Of, are you talking about through LEAD?
The future, what you're talking about.
So I'll turn that over to you, Lori, because I'm not quite sure.
I think if we can kind of let Insha continue with her program, and we can have an offline conversation, but I think your question is the general question about the jail, should there be one built? That's Greene County, that would be, yes. But we're talking about here is, you know, some alternatives to jail. So.
That's exactly right. And in New York State, there are actually no private jails or prisons.
Right.
So that's one less thing to contend with, but that's just important, I think, to know. So LEAD is an option at the moment of arrest. What about for judges, right, to have a different option than what they're currently doing? So one idea is at arraignments, which is when somebody gets arrested and they're brought in front of a judge for their first hearing. That's arraignment. And that's the time at which the judge makes a decision, do I set bail or do I release somebody on their own recognizance? And if I do set bail, how much bail do I set? And so one of the things I specialize in is working on bail practices. I do trainings across the state with judges on bail. And judges, even though our law on bail is actually quite progressive and allows judges to consider what can a person afford when judges set bail, so often judges don't know that or they don't actually do that. And so one very simple thing Greene County can do is educate and train judges on what are called alternative forms of bail, which are forms of bail that are, say, for example, a partially secured bond, which is bail might still get set at, say, $5,000, but the partially secured part is that the person would put up no more than 10%. So on a $5,000 bond, they would be required to put up no more than $500 in order to secure their freedom and come back to court, and they would pay that money to the court as opposed to a bail bondsman. And the upshot is if a person went to a bail bondsman to pay a $5,000 bond, they would lose that 10% deposit that they pay. That's just gone. It, you know, it goes to the bail bondsman. With a partially secured bond, that 10% goes to the court. The court holds it in escrow, and so long as the person comes back for all of their court dates, they get that money back at the end of the case, whether the charges are dismissed or there's a conviction or what. So the idea is that is cheaper for people to afford than the full $5,000. It's easier to afford $500 than $5,000. But if the person warrants, they don't come back to court and bail is forfeited, they're actually on the hook for the remaining $4,500. So that's one option. Judges can set partially secured bonds, and I encourage judges, instead of setting an insurance company bail bond, which is to the bail bond company, if you're going to do that, set a partially secured bond because it's takes out the profit-making middleman, and it's just easier for people to afford. The other thing that judges can do is set an unsecured bond, which is, again, they could set $5,000 bail, but the person doesn't actually have to put up any money. The idea is, say they have a paycheck or a public assistance check coming in a month or in a couple of weeks, but they don't have any money right now, they're still good for that amount should they warrant it. Their paycheck can be, you know, their wages can be garnished, but just the fact that they don't have immediate access to cash isn't what's holding them in jail. And so I actually did a study in New York City with judges where I trained judges on setting partially secured and unsecured bonds, and for a period of 3 months, we followed judges who actually used these forms of bail to find out what happened with these cases. And so we have 99 cases in which judges set a partially secured or an unsecured bond. Two-thirds of everybody was able to make bail. I don't know what the numbers are in here in Greene County, but I'm pretty sure, because this is true across the state, when bail gets set, less than half of all New Yorkers are able to afford it. Most people can't afford $1,000 bail, let alone $5,000 bail. And so, you know, we found more people were able to make bail. And we also found that people came back to court at the exact same rates as they did if, like, a full bail was set and they were able to make that full amount. Because judges are often like, well, if they're only paying a little bit of it, not the full amount, won't it make them less likely to come back to court? Our research showed, nope. People came back to court at the same rates.
This sounds much better than what Hudson's tried altruistically to have a private bail fund. Mm-hmm. But what you're talking about is very good because it still integrates carefully with the legal system.
Yep.
It's not an external, it's not extracurricular.
Yep. And Scott, I wonder if what you're talking about is the Columbia County Bail Fund. Is that what you're referencing?
Yeah.
So one thing that has come about in a couple of different
which we were considering setting up, but this is much, much more rigorous, and it does the job of what bail is about, getting back, keep you in the loop, and not have you necessarily in a box.
Yep. It's also, it forces judges and the courts to really look at their own practices, which is what you need in terms of sustainable and durable reform, as opposed to letting judges and the courts sort of do bail as usual and then paying the bail on the back end if there's no sort of training or push to actually change how bail is getting set in the first place. It makes it really challenging to change it.
Do you have any insight as to why OCA isn't teaching judges better about this?
Well, so you know what's really interesting about that is, so I do trainings with OCA, so maybe I will be a little bit of an apologist for them, but I actually think they are working really hard to try and train judges. So each summer they have the Judicial Training Institute where all of the OCA judges, so that's all of your city court and your county court judges, they're all OCA judges, they all get trained.
Those aren't the people that benefit our arraignments.
And then, so here's the thing, there's town and village courts as well, right, the justice courts, and there are justices. I'm actually training all of the justices across New York State on alternative forms of bail at their annual conference in September, and I am doing trainings. I'm literally going to be on the road for a week at the end of July to talk with justice court judges about alternative forms of bail and doing bail differently, because what I've seen, just at least from my travels across New York State, is that's often where bail is getting set. It's sometimes not in the city courts where there are often pretrial services. There are other options, or there are judges who feel like they don't have to set bail in every case.
There are lawyer judges, too.
Exactly. And so the town and village court judges are, under our state constitution, not required to be judges. And 70% of them...
Lawyers.
Yeah. Thank you. Somebody is listening. They're not required to be lawyers, and about 70% of them are, in fact, not lawyers. And look, like in some counties, like St. Lawrence County, right, there are very few actual lawyers. It's a very rural county. And so I get why it's the case under our constitution, but it makes it really challenging in terms of administering justice and making sure people, judges, know the law as they're setting bail.
It seems to be going towards something called a regional jail, a regional court system, which is an answer to what you're saying, where you have village and town judges who don't have a day of law school, and instead you want people at arraignments, you want real judges, you want people with legal experience, and you also want a public defender.
Yeah, so Scott, you're jumping the gun. Let me get to this. Centralized arraignment parts. That is my next suggestion of something that should be considered and maybe is being considered in Greene County. And there are four counties across the state that have looked at this. And what it is there is one court, it's usually the biggest city court, so here it would be Catskill Court probably, where arraignments is set up sort of full-time, there is always a lawyer judge. There is always a public defender available or court-appointed counsel. There's always an assistant district attorney, because often in your town and village court arraignments, there's no ADA present, right? There's no public defender necessarily present either. It's just the judge and oftentimes the arresting officer. So in a centralized arraignment part, it's set up full-time from 9 to 5, maybe even 5 to 1 a.m., or there are like after-hours arraignments if need be. And so there's a judge, a public defender, assistant district attorney. Importantly, there's also pretrial services there. It's often from the Department of Probation and ATI services, who has somebody there in court who can interview people as they're being arrested to actually screen them for pretrial services. There's a clerk present who can do all the paperwork. All of the challenges with arraignments off hours can be handled in a centralized arraignment part. The Office of Court Administration piloted this in 4 counties last year, and by all accounts, it's been really, really successful. Even counties like Oneida County, which is a really big county and has many town and village court justices, they found that they've actually really liked having one centralized arraignment part and being able to sort of streamline the arraignment process, even though initially there was some opposition from the towns and villages to say, we don't want you, big city, doing our arraignments. Turns out, sort of almost a year in, it's actually been better for everybody. It's more cost-effective. And in fact, it looks like they're sending fewer people to jail because there are alternatives. There's judges who are releasing more. They're setting, you know, forms of bail where they're considering what somebody can afford, and they're actually putting people in pretrial services and release under supervision right at the moment of arrest and not after the person has already been in jail.
The shortcoming in Greene County is Oneida has 2 cities, Rome and Utica.
Yep.
You have large legal population. We don't have a lot of lawyer judges. Catskill doesn't have any lawyer judges.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't have pretrial services readily available.
Yep.
So while it's a wonderful idea, centralized arraignment, arraignment parts, and we should be going there, but the reality is we just don't have the staff for it.
Yeah, and it's something to think about in that sort of, you know, the $5.3 million that you spend a year on the jail, which is a cost that's going to continue to exist, right? But maybe some of those funds can be used to actually staff up or to, you know, push for OCA to send a lawyer judge here, or to really train one of your justice court judges. You know,
we have lawyer judges in the county, but they're just not in Catskill.
They're not in Catskill, right. And so it might be that it's going to wherever those folks are and recognizing that that's their assignment, right? Or, you know, there's ways to work around it, but I hear you, that I think one of the challenges is you don't have a release under supervision or a pretrial services program, and sort of building that from scratch is not easy, although I will say I've seen many counties and many, you know, sort of smaller cities do that and do it quite effectively. It doesn't require nearly as much in the way of resources as one would think. It's certainly cheaper. Certainly cheaper.
We have room in our probation department. They have their overstaffed is not the best way to say it, but they have their caseload is low.
Yeah, they might have capacity. That's exactly right. And so, you know, one of the great places to look in terms of figuring out how maybe to get pretrial services as part of the Department of Probation is Monroe County. They have an excellent pretrial services program where the director of the program, Craig, is really thoughtful about talking to other upstate counties to figure out, like, sort of what can you do with the limited resources that you have. Other programs that I think are really effective and are working well across the rest of New York State, an opioid court. Buffalo opened the nation's first opioid court about a year ago, and by all accounts, it really, the job of the court is to keep people alive. In Greene County, you have, I think, the third highest in the state rate of opioid overdose deaths.
You're number one in heroin.
I think we're first.
Is it number one?
Well, it's third in general opioid and first in heroin.
Wow.
But let's remember that's a per capita. And, you know,
I'm
not making any
yep.
plea. Don't make
yep.
that. It doesn't misunderstand, but the raw numbers just are
small.
Yeah.
Compared to our 49,000 annual population.
Yes. Agreed. I think we can all agree, though, one death is too many,
absolutely.
Right? But yes, I hear you. That point is well taken. But these courts, these specialized courts, and there's now one in New York City. There are planning to be more sort of across the country as well, and I think across New York State. It's been found to be incredibly effective. In Buffalo, they've had over 90 people, is by my last sort of count, go through the program and actually be, you know, in the way that recovery works, they are doing okay. They are more stable than when they came into the program, and that's a real win for Erie County that has an incredibly high both per capita as well as just like hard numbers of overdoses from opioid use.
The other thing we found in looking at the data was the relationship between drug abuse and property crime.
Yeah. Yes. And that goes back to the point I was making earlier that 65%, so almost two-thirds of the folks who are in on violations of probation, which I bet if I looked at the data more closely, it's for, you know, violations of probation that have to do with a dirty urine or a new arrest for drug possession or drug use. Property crimes very closely often correlate with drug use as well. So absolutely, those all seem to be circling around the same issue. And so the idea is there might be folks for who just a drop-off center doesn't feel like enough, and that's when something like an opioid court that is a more structured, rigorous sort of engagement and process of treatment is something you might want to consider. Again, resources, for sure, there's no doubt about that, but cheaper than jail, and it also saves lives and connects people to treatment in a way that jail, we all know, just simply can't.
We're also noticing that those sort of programs are often paid by the state and the federal government,
yep.
So it's not out of the local taxpayer dollar, but it also works.
Yeah, and I know that you all, from reading your minutes, have talked extensively about where you can get away SAS funding and other kinds of funding to address some of the treatment needs. And then the last thing I want to point out is what is colloquially known as like a second look program, and that's for folks who do end up in the jail, if that's here in Greene County or in Columbia or wherever, to do a sort of like a rapid response, to have somebody whose job, and this might be in the Department of Probation or in some other entity, where their job is to review the daily jail rosters to figure out who can we get out, who can we work with the district attorney's office, with court-appointed counsel or the public defender to get these people out quicker. And they're often the folks who could go into treatment or could benefit from an alternative to incarceration or a job employment program or something along those lines. Again, it might just be one person whose job it is to sort of scan the daily jail roster, but in places that have implemented those kinds of programs, in New York City for women, because it turns out in the past couple of years more and more women are going to jail in New York City, and it's again for drug and property crimes. That's something that New York City has done recently, and it's had a tremendous impact. I know other places are also considering this kind of model.
What's the chance of that person being a non-adversarial sort of professional, meaning a mm-hmm. mental health or a
yep.
social service, rather than somebody in law enforcement who has maybe a different motive?
Sure.
So
I think that's a decision for the county, right? I will say I've worked with many departments of probation across the state where the folks who are there have the sort of mindset of treatment and social work and counseling, not necessarily law enforcement, but that's really about sort of how you write that job description and how you're thinking about oversight and authority. But you want to have somebody who is sort of trained and you know, familiar with counseling and social work sort of principles, who can play a neutral role to talk with the district attorney's office and sort of help negotiate some sort of disposition to get that person out. I think that is an important part of that.
Following up on what you said about who can you get out of the jail, have you had an opportunity to take a look at our average length of stay and compare it to the statewide averages?
Yeah, and I've seen a couple of different average length of stay numbers sort of floating around. There's a number from the Richie Green report, right, so I won't go there. You know, it sounds like, what was your average length of stay? It's 41? Am I remembering that right?
Oh, gosh.
I think it's 41.
I think so.
Yeah, sounds about right.
Yeah.
Don't quote me on that. We'll look it up. But what I remember, my best recollection, is 41 days, and that's high. And one of the reasons I think that that is happening is you have a not small number of misdemeanor cases in your jail, and a lot of those cases are coming out of, I think, town and village courts, where the courts don't meet all that frequently, right? So the person's going to be in jail for 2, 3, maybe even 4 weeks between court dates. So even if it only takes 3 court dates to get their case resolved, that's still, you know, 3 months perhaps that they are in jail. So that's what my best guess is of what's driving up that length of stay number, because you do have, it's a rural county where you have a lot of town and village courts actually handling the cases that are coming into the jail. So that's my best guess for that. And then,
just to interject from the report, the ATI report, it looks like the most recent data is 39 days.
39 days, okay. So, still long.
That's from 2014, though, so it's not as accurate.
I have here from dates of beginning of April through to beginning of this month, most of them have been in 51, 52, 53, 54.
We're not talking population, we're talking average length of stay.
Yeah, that's what it is.
That's our research.
Total days of stay, that's what it is.
So this was, I think, a 10-year look back as opposed to a couple-month look back. So.
Okay.
What is the state's average, please?
So I don't know of a number that has actually looked at across local jails, how long people are staying in. Nationally, the number is 21 days across the country, and that's a statistic from the U.S. Department of Justice, from the Bureau of Justice Statistics. New York County, every county that I've worked with has a slightly higher average length of stay, at least where we've done that analysis. In part because I think we have a system of town and village courts. There are literally 1,200 of them across New York State, and that's where a lot of local justice is happening. And most town and village courts, unless you're in a big town or a big village, you're not meeting all that frequently. Most are meeting every 3 to 4 weeks. That tends to be their schedule.
You had a statistic of about 50% being pretrial detainees, which means that's 50% are post-conviction.
Yes, or they're sentenced, or they are
parole violators.
Right.
Which have no general court return dates.
Yes, exactly.
So is the 50% number a high number or a low number?
So one of the things I wanted to ask you all, since I don't have case level data from your court system, I wanted to actually ask, like, does that feel right, or does that actually feel low? It's low compared to the rest of New York State. I actually bet if you sort of pull out maybe some of the folks who are being held in on a parole violation but also have a new case or something like that, I bet that number's actually higher because it feels a little bit low to me.
You mean the 50% pretrial detainees should be higher?
Yeah. So in our entire state of incarceration report, I got that from Richie Green because that was the only one. I'm sorry. But I was just going through all of the resources that I know. Just going through all of the resources that we know. And look, 50% is still an opportunity to do something different. So I went with the most conservative number. If you look at federal Department of Justice data, which is a little bit outdated, it's from 2015. If you look at admissions, the pretrial admissions from federal data, so it's from the U.S. Census of Jails, actually gets us at about, I want to say, 76% of Greene County's jail are, or maybe it's actually 67%. I'm sorry. I'll look that up, and I will share that with Lori to share with you. It was a much higher number. I wasn't sure. I didn't see that confirmed in the other reports that you guys have done, so I went with the conservative number, but I actually think it's higher than 50%. So the last thing I want to sort of formally touch on, and I really do want it to open up sort of for questions, ideas, thoughts, is just the idea of a shared jail. This is not something we do in New York State, and that is just simply because, like many, many parts of this country, states, you know, are their own fiefdoms, and counties within states are really their own sort of fiefdoms. And so historically in America and in New York State, we've just had one jail per county, like we've had one prosecutor per county, like we've had one sheriff per county. It just is part of, like, law enforcement tradition. But just because it is tradition doesn't mean it is law and that we can't do things differently. And so one of the things about sharing a jail with Columbia, which I know has been part of the conversation, is that even legal? And I want to touch upon first, across the country, there are now, and this is really a development of the last sort of couple of decades, there are 76 existing regional jails in 21 states across the U.S. So several states have looked at precisely this question, and they have either changed their state laws, or they have created sort of administrative like agreements to have, you know, one jail across two or more counties. So this exists. This happens in the rest of the country. It can certainly happen here in New York State if that is the right decision for this county. And then specifically, so the legality and mechanics. Like I said, there's a number of different ways to get to having a regional jail, which is a jail across multiple counties. One is you actually create statutory authority, meaning you change the law to allow for a shared or a regional jail. Pamela Young, who is a Republican state senator, has actually sponsored legislation for the past couple of years in New York State to allow for counties to share, to do shared services, and specifically to share a jail. So this is actually an idea that has traction among, you know, state legislators, including Republican legislators. And the reason why for Senator Young is her district has a lot of more rural counties where sort of supporting their own jail, again, it's counties that are sort of in the 50,000, you know, region in terms of census, it makes a lot of sense for a couple of counties to share one jail as opposed to running a county facility that has 50 beds, all within a couple of hours of each other, just have one jail that actually can meet the capacity for all of those counties. The second you can do, which doesn't require any sort of legislative change or state law change, is just have a cooperative agreement between the two counties or the two jurisdictions. So that would be Greene County and Columbia County coming to an agreement. It's something you do in a number of other circumstances. Some work better than others. You'd really have to think carefully about how to have that shared agreement to make sure it doesn't sort of disadvantage Greene County, but it is totally doable. Other places do it. It is an option here. And then another sort of cooperative agreement structure, which doesn't really apply here, is for a local jurisdiction, a county, to enter into an agreement with the state to house inmates who are state inmates. So that happens in places like Pennsylvania and Louisiana, where they're often holding people for the state in local jails. And then the fourth part is have statutory authority, have laws that actually name the counties that can be part of a regional jail, right? And so, again, that would be going to Albany and asking Albany to make an exception for the Hudson Valley region or for other regions across the state where this kind of shared structure might make sense. So it is doable here. It is potentially, I would say, arguably legal under our existing law. If folks wanted to get behind sort of pushing for statutory change, there's already momentum in Albany, as I'm sure many of you already know. So but it's a possibility.
There was a bill in the Senate since 2010 that Bonnet put through, a Republican.
Yeah.
And it was only picked up once in the Assembly. Yeah. And yet, I worked with them for 3 months saying, well, tell us, why are you bothering to put it on the floor? And they said, we think it's actually already legal, so we didn't really push it any harder. Mm-hmm. So their legal departments of each of those groups said it's not necessary.
Yeah.
Have you had any conversations with State Commission on Corrections with regard to this issue? Or this solution, I suspect, rather
yes.
than issue?
Do you mean specifically about a shared jail? Not on the record. But do I think...
If you were to have a conversation, what do you think it might be?
So here's my, and now I am giving you advice. No, you can leave it on. Is you should absolutely raise those conversations with the State Commission of Corrections, but raise it in the context of also what are we doing to handle the problem with Greene County, right? I think my sense, and you know, sort of forgive me if I'm speaking out of turn or if I don't understand the politics fully, but the relationship that Greene County has had with the State Commission of Corrections has mostly gone through the sheriff, which makes sense because the State Commission of Corrections is the oversight body for local jails, but that relationship has been...
not pretty.
Yeah, it's been fraught, to be frank, right? And I think it's incumbent upon the county and county legislators to figure out how to create a perhaps more collaborative relationship with the State Commission of Corrections. Is that telling me to, like, stop? I've stepped over.
Now you can speak even more nicely.
Now you can go off the record.
Okay, great.
Yeah, you can go. It's still being recorded.
Tell us what you really think.
So I foiled 5 years of their correspondence. It's ugly. And they were placated. The attorney here tried to do everything he could. But, I mean, it just turns into thin paper very quickly. And I'm not going to say anything.
Yeah.
So the question of is it legal is a big question.
Yeah.
And that's been put out there. I mean, that's really one of the key questions, I think, that's hanging up this whole issue. And nobody seems to have a definitive answer.
And so here's my sort of, from looking at what we have looked at, is since there is nothing expressly prohibiting it, in fact, there is very little that actually addresses this issue.
There's a paragraph in the charter.
Yep.
And even that is, you know.
It's ambiguous.
Not to disagree with you, but first of all, the DA and the sheriff are constitutional officers.
Mm-hmm.
They're not required by statute. It's different. The Constitution, that would never be a change.
Yep.
Jails, on the other hand, under 217 of the corrections law,
yep.
it is a mandated. Each county must have a jail, is the way it's written.
No, wait.
I've read the statute.
But Greg,
it
that's incorrect.
That's not correct, right?
It doesn't say it has to be in the county.
It says must operate.
Must operate.
That is
exactly.
A critical word.
You guys can split it up. I have also read
the statute really carefully, and there's nothing requiring literally a physical plant of a jail in each county. There is certainly each county, because each county is sort of its own entity, they have to have oversight and operations of the ability to incarcerate people.
If it got
so
to
that's
the
a jail.
Current, if it got to the Court of Appeals the way it's currently made up, I think that your interpretation would be very strained.
Then
I
you're
think,
not
going to
argue
that
a case in the Court of
well,
Appeals because
wait,
it's not...
But look at it reasonably and logically. I mean, when this law was created back in 1850, or whenever the heck it was created, the clear intent was to have a jail in every county.
Yeah.
And original intent is one of those things that, you know, for something like that. But I'm not saying it can't be changed because it's a statute.
Yep.
You know, it's a
it
statute
is,
that
it's
can
statute.
Readily be changed
yep.
by Senator Young, by her statute. If Senator Bonasek put in
mm-hmm.
shared financing this past year
yep.
that was passed by this, but you know, so
yep.
I'm just remember where I'm coming from, folks.
Yeah, no, I hear
but
that.
But I just want to make sure I understand from your perspective where we are.
Yeah, so the way I understood that question is kind of like, what can you do as a county if you are interested in exploring the sort of shared jail option? What can you do to shore yourselves up? I think one thing is to reopen that relationship with the State Commission of Corrections and reach out, sort of saying, we're not leaving this up to solely one entity, the sheriff, to have this relationship. We want to make sure this is a county decision, not just the decision of one member of the county. And then I think another thing you should consider doing is, you know, reaching out to your state legislators, which you've already been doing. And then think about this is, if you do decide to go that route, then really the work is to sort of create a favorable agreement for Greene County with Columbia and say 10 years from now, if that does wind through the Court of Appeals and it comes out saying your interpretation, which is there needs to be a physical jail in each county, well, then you've essentially sort of kick that decision down the line in terms of building, but I don't think you've actually lost anything as a county other than you've given yourselves more time to see, can we reduce our jail population? Can we really sort of do incarceration differently before we decide to build a new jail? And I hope in this period, much in the way that you have, you are looking at your data very carefully, literally each and every month, because it will tell you how big should you build if that is in fact what happens down the road. I just think at this particular moment when you have, remember this, like Governor Cuomo and the executive branch is who manages the State Commission of Corrections, right? And in order to be challenged on, you know, whether there needs to be a physical jail in each county, who would that challenger be? Chances it might be somebody from within the county who wants
a new physical?
Sheriff's Association.
Well, yes. in the west of New York State, it was the COs who shut down one of the two of the potential regional jail events just by politically lobbying until it got snuffed out.
Mm-hmm.
But it does seem like Bonachick's office and Young's office both need to push more legislation because their position is it's already perfectly fine.
So, I mean, I'm just sort of playing this out, right? It will take years to wind through the courts if there is a legal challenge. And given Governor Cuomo's position on bail reform, on criminal justice reform, on discovery reform, on speedy trial reform, we're just at a very, exactly, in shared services as well for many other contexts, law enforcement, medical care, all of those sorts of things. We're just at a very different moment politically than, say, even 5 years ago in terms of thinking about doing criminal justice differently, including sort of jail. So know that I think if that is the decision that the county takes, you sort of have the, like, force of political winds on your side, which is not nothing. That's not a small thing. I think you will not receive that much pushback from Albany so long as those relationships are handled carefully.
Would it be fair to say that we could possibly build the last of the big white whale jails?
Yes.
Well,
yeah.
Were we to build, I think.
Were you to build?
So just to make sure I'm understanding your last point correctly, and I do want to just add one thing about the role of the State Commission of Correction. So I think your last point is, in light of, you know, our current governor and the current sort of state of affairs at the state, that were there ever, it's a question about legality and whether there's, you know, a prohibition at this point or whether we could in fact do this sort of right now. Were we to move forward with some sort of shared jail, and were there to be a challenge, which would likely happen locally,
mm-hmm.
that would likely take a long time for that to be sorted out, and that we really have the sort of support of the state. So I just want to say, add one point to your point about not having had these conversations with the State Commission of Corrections on the record. I have, on the record, had conversations with Joseph Popkin, who is the governor's assistant deputy secretary, who oversees the State Commission of Corrections, and he has been very clear that there is this support that you are talking about at the state level, so that, you know,
yeah,
whatever that piece is worth. And do you have more to do? Because some of my colleagues who are on the legislature joined us. They weren't able to be here at 4.
Nope.
I would love it if you could circle back to the piece about Tompkins County and Ulster County and those experiences. I think that would be helpful for those folks if you could be so kind as
more
to do
than
that.
Happy to do that. And I want to make sure I answer your question first. So you had your hand up.
Yes.
Sorry. I didn't see
it back. As Lori's points are all well taken, a question from the strategic point of view of when the county does go for underwriting in this climate, is it going to be likely more favorable for the county to go for borrowing in general? Should it go to the well for things other than a jail? To have a lower encumbrance for jail pods or jail cells, new construction, in proportion to its general budget. Because the number of jail pods that are delivered are going to cause a statutory requirement for a certain staffing, which will institutionalize expense budgets going forward in the years, regardless of whether there is an actual need for these cells or not. Whereas, if we are going with a shared alternative, it will be an easier paradigm to adjust. Our debt will be considerably lessened, and our financial flexibility and options to do things that would actually grow our economy rather than give a bunch of incompetent sheriffs a job.
No. Okay. So I'm going to jump in to just say
the cause.
maximum facility capacity is essentially what's that issue there. Mm-hmm. So the way it's required under the New York State rules and regulations is for jails, they have to be staffed to their maximum facility capacity. So if the facility capacity is 100 beds, even if there are in any given day a maximum of 50 people actually incarcerated in the jail, staffing has to be for 100 beds. And so for jails like Ulster County that I will circle back to just as a note of caution, I suppose, or a learning lesson for Green as you move forward, they have to maintain a staffing structure for the maximum capacity of that jail, even if they have empty beds on any given day. And so where I started this was just to sort of make the point of if you build it, they will come. Meaning if you build a bigger jail, those beds likely will get filled. And so Ulster County is a good illustration of this. In 2007, they put a new jail online that was significantly bigger than their old jail. And this chart shows the jail incarceration rate in Ulster County over the past two decades. Yes.
I just want to correct something I stated before. It was the total number of men and women in the jail on any given day during those times. It's not the length of stay.
Right. Got it. Thank you for that. I appreciate that. So in Ulster County, this red line is their jail incarceration rate. The statewide jail incarceration rate today is about 200 residents per 100,000 residents. And in Ulster County, until they built a new jail in 2007, they historically always had a jail incarceration rate that was below the state average. Why? In part because they had a smaller jail. And so they knew that if they filled the jail to the max, they would have to pay more money than it was allocated in their county budget to actually outboard people. And so that is just a natural sort of check to make sure that the court system is working as it should to be judicious about the use of incarceration, who ends up in jail. Once the jail expanded, what I've heard anecdotally from spending some time and talking with folks and working in Ulster County is judges who perhaps 15 years ago would have just released somebody on their own recognizance or sort of worked to figure out a bail amount that the person could afford to come back to court would just set higher bails or just not sort of think that carefully about whether or not this particular case or this particular defendant needed to be in jail pretrial. And so that's where you see that growth in Ulster County. Somebody mentioned earlier the sort of scandal of the Ulster County Jail. It went way over budget by several million dollars. It was delivered sort of several years after it was promised. There was significant litigation about some of the practices, some of the sort of waste and mismanagement of building that jail. And interestingly enough, Ulster County, that has historically had a Republican county legislature, ended up going Democratic in, I want to say, 2014 or sometime recently, in part because of, at least the way it sort of gets told in the media, in part because of the fallout from the new jail and that jail construction. Most recently, Ulster County has been in the news for taking some inmates that are outboarded from Greene County since the Greene County Jail closed in April of this year.
Just to clarify, the Ulster County switched to Democrat in 2006 amidst this litigation over the cost overruns, and that was the first time it had switched in over 25 years.
Got it. So it was sort of tied to this particular moment. So compare Ulster County, which I think is just an interesting sort of lesson of what can happen with the use of incarceration if you build to Tompkins County.
And clarify again, throughout this time, this increased incarceration rate is not commensurate with any increase in
crime.
Reported crime or crime. It is simply a choice of utilization of a resource.
That's exactly right. I mean, I want to really underscore that. I think oftentimes the belief is, and an understandable belief by residents and citizens and community members, that more incarceration yields more public safety. We've seen numerous examples of where places have actually decreased their reliance on incarceration and increased public safety. New York City is the big sort of like obvious
example of that, literally back in 1992, we had over 20,000 people in jail on any given day. And then today we have about 8,300. We have the lowest crime rate New York City does that it has had literally in the 55 years that the federal government has been, collecting crime statistics. So that's an example of how literally you can use incarceration less and actually get more public safety.
It's even more dramatic. Rikers is being closed, and one of the reasons was Judge Lipman had said he had to retire, and he took on that particular task, knowing it was the large task. It was 27 acres of incredible harsh conditions, and that was successful. It's a remarkable. No one thought that heavy lifting would occur. And the crime hasn't gone up, and the safety of the communities is better.
Yep.
And the little number of little regional county jails in the borough is perfectly fine, and everybody's being managed differently.
Yeah, Rikers hasn't been closed yet, but there is a plan put in place to close Rikers. Yeah.
The other thing, just underscore what you said, that no matter where that red line goes, the cost of operating the Ulster jail remain the same.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Even if literally it goes way down to where it was back in 1995, Ulster County will still be paying the same amount of money for operating that jail.
Hold on a second. Do you have a snapshot of a similar county to us in size? Not necessarily size, but a snapshot of a county that went to direct supervision. And what their percentage of increase to their corrections budget went up to staff that properly.
Mm-hmm.
Because we have not determined yet what our staffing, our operational costs will be come a new jail build. And that's a very important component to a decision here.
If you're going to
have to increase your budget 20% to pay for increased labor costs,
You'll be lucky. I'm thinking 50%.
You know what's interesting? So the costs of running a direct supervision model of jail are less than a linear model that's been shown through research across the country. I'm happy to share some examples of reports that have actually compared the costs of operating and sort of like what the simple management is of a direct supervision jail versus a linear jail. But actually, sort of, those costs should go down if a direct supervision jail is built or a modified direct supervision jail.
The point here is this current capacity of the Greene County Jail was 56 prior to everything, where the proposal on the table is a 98-bed facility. So.
Right. So here's the thing is, because you're doubling the capacity of the jail, there is no cost savings. I mean, how could there be, right? If you are doubling capacity, it doesn't matter what the structure of the jail looks like. And I can look to examples. There aren't actually that many direct supervision jails across the United States. It's something that's been done for a long time in Europe. It's relatively new here. But I can look to some examples.
I know St. Lawrence County was a jail I had visited, was is direct supervision.
Mm-hmm.
I think they opened in
about six years ago.
Yeah, and that might be an example. I know they're a larger county, but you might have a snapshot right there of their linear jail, how many it was approved for, and now their direct supervision. I think they were like 180 or 185 beds in their new direct supervision. And
which was a lot bigger than their old jail.
I think so. And so you can have a comparison as to right there. I didn't do it myself.
Okay.
I didn't do the homework there. But
that's a great example. I'll look into it. Yeah.
Well, we don't know the operation cost of this. That's one of the other things that's just amazing. And when I sat through this discussion with the engineers, every minute of it, and so they described this building, and then they described the land it's on, and then they described, oh, by the way, you have to heat it. And things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have to change the roof after 15 years and things like that. And none of those are built into the advance notice to the county.
Well, there's an appropriated budget every single year that goes towards corrections and incarceration. And that, again, is something that can be decided by the county, right? You're locked into a certain amount that will just go off the bat to running a facility that is bigger or that requires more staffing. That's just a fact, right? But I think you know, to the point where you can't anticipate costs? Well, you can actually, because you can make some choices about how you're allocating your county budget. And so I just want to go to the next example, which is Tompkins County. So unlike Ulster County, which faced the prospect of whether or not to build a new jail and decided in 2007, yes, we're going to build, Tompkins County has been considering that same question for several years now and have consistently decided against building a jail. Their jail incarceration rate has historically remained very low, and again, anecdotally from talking to folks in Tompkins County, it's because they've invested in services like pretrial services and figuring out how do we not put people in jail, how do we safely keep them in the community instead of using incarceration, and they are constrained, again, by how big the size of their jail is. They don't actually outboard many people, if any inmates at all. And their decision to not build a jail, you can see that line of their jail incarceration rate has stayed flat over many, many years. And to Lori's point that I think is a really important one, their crime rates certainly have not gone up or down. They have actually remained pretty flat, as is true for Ulster County as well. And so again, just to compare the two, you see Ulster versus Tompkins. And then to the point about budgets and appropriations, last year Tompkins County appropriated and spent $5.3 million on its jail. It's a county of 105,000 people. Ulster County, which is about 180,000 people, it incarcerates at twice the rate of Tompkins County. They appropriated and spent $22.3 million on their jail. And because it's just a much, much bigger jail than perhaps what that county needs. And I had raised this later in the presentation, but Greene County's appropriation for incarceration for the costs of operating a jail, including outboarding people, last year was also $5.3 million. You're a much smaller county, much, much smaller than Tompkins County. You're half the size. So just to put all of that in proportion of what's happening in other, you know, neighboring counties that, you know, don't look that different, or at least there are lessons to be learned from them.
Going back to the discussion a little bit earlier about the comparative cost of linear versus, if we were to build a jail of the same size today and change the model, would it require less staffing? So there would be job loss simply from
efficiency. So here's the thing. I don't think there needs to be job loss, as in layoffs, because as I think is true, but correct me if I'm wrong, whatever sort of union contracts the Greene County jail staff, so corrections officers, have, it looks like the contracts that most sheriff's departments and jail authorities have across the state, which is at 20 years, people can retire or choose to sort of, you know, move on. And I believe, although tell me if I'm wrong, that there are a number of people who currently work at the, or did work at the Greene County Jail when it was open, who are reaching that 20-year mark. And so what you can have is just sort of natural attrition. It doesn't require that you actually have layoffs. There might be a little bit of sort of excess staffing for some period of time, but I actually think there's a way to manage that. That's a conversation New York City is having. New York City has a correctional force of over 10,000 officers. 10,000 officers. There are more officers employed by the City Department of Corrections than there are people incarcerated in the New York City jails. And the idea is, it's right, exactly. So you want to talk about excess and look at New York City. But the idea is, with the plan that Judge Lippman and his commission came up with, was in fact to decrease the number of people in jail by looking at exactly what we had talked about earlier. What can we do in terms of different options for the police at the moment of arrest? What can we do for judges to give them more options to not just rely on jail? And what can we do once people are in the jail to get them out more quickly if that is, in fact, the appropriate alternative? Similarly, the Lippman Commission came up with a plan for how to get the New York City jail population down to 5,000 people on any given day, which is close to half of what it is now, without laying off a single corrections officer, because we'll rely on natural attrition. And there, you know, it's, there's a lot of work for corrections officers to do that isn't just simply oversight and supervision, but there's more they can be doing in terms of programming, in terms of helping with reentry, in terms of helping with any number of other things that are really beneficial for people incarcerated.
Did you
question.
Oh, I just had a question. Because behavioral modification is the foundation for direct supervision jails, are correction officers paid more because of this training? That's question A. And then question B is looking at classification. I think New York State has said that we can mix classifications, but still, within that pod, do you have to have a separate correction officer if you have a subpod? And I would think that the smaller the jail, the less savings you would have for direct supervision as opposed to a larger jail. I think direct supervision is great, but I was really...
So you know one really interesting thing that I've heard around the country is in places that do have a jail that's built in a direct supervision model, the way the pods can work is, say there are, you know, there are empty beds, you can literally close a pod, and it's cheaper than trying to close one long linear corridor. You just simply can't do that in a way that creates sort of cost savings, say, if you do overbuild or there's just a dip in the number of people there. I don't actually know the answer to whether corrections officers get paid differently based on what the physical plant of the jail looks like. My sense is no. I haven't heard anything like that.
Are there scope of training, because you would think that they would have a higher level of
Here's the thing is the training should be the same either which way, right? I mean, I'm happy to put you in touch with the sheriff who runs the Alexandria, Virginia jail, who's really thoughtful about training his staff in their jobs as corrections officers. I remember walking through that jail and being sort of surprised at how much freedom people have. Literally, you see inmates walking, which in most jails, and I've been to more jails than I can count, you don't see that. And literally, I turned to the officer who was walking me around, and I was like, does that make you nervous? And he's like, no, because, like, everybody really appreciates their freedom, and they have a ton of respect for how they're treated, which is with respect. It's what we're all trained and we're taught. We have our own sort of, like, skills that we're trained in terms of, like, crisis management and de-escalation. It's good for us, too.
I don't want correction officers to be paid less.
It's a great question, but one of the interesting things is, like, some of that comes down to the union contract, and some of that comes down to what you're, again, in that sort of corrections appropriation as a county, what are you willing to, you know, pay for in terms of training corrections officers in terms of providing those resources for them as well. One thing I always say is, you know, corrections officers should also have, like, a break room and a place where they can, you know, like any of us who are workers, we want people to be treated well in their workplace. That is their workplace. Like, those are really important things, as well as making sure there's enough in the way of facilities and resources for the people incarcerated there, for inmates as well.
But it remains useful to understand that a county jail is very different than a prison. So you're really basically holding people temporarily until you figure out what to do to the largest extent. And if somebody's really convicted, they go to prison. So the concept of a county jail is what New York City has gotten back to, where it's just a temporary place. And it's not supposed to be a big, elaborate, fancy environment. It's just, okay, something's going on. Let's take a look. And let's do it as competently as possible.
I don't disagree with that, but considering that you've had a number of tragedies in the jail, it's clear, like, the way that the jail is working isn't working.
Be the way the jail is managed rather than the architecture, and that's part of the observation I have personally.
You know, I, as somebody who is an expert in jails, and I've been to more jails than I can count, I think, yes, even if people are in jail for a short period of time, making sure that there are adequate resources. There are things like a single stop program, right, which for every single person before they're released from jail, there's a scan of what public benefits are you eligible for, what about your food stamps, what about your Medicaid, you know, sort of what's your plan for release, a discharge plan. Those are really basic things that every single jail in this country should be doing. Jails should have opportunities for education and schooling, a good library, all of those things. Because the thing is, like, everybody who goes to jail comes back out, right? And if they are no better, positioned when they're coming out, we know where they're going again. I don't know what the numbers are in Greene County of the folks who sort of are cycling through, but my guess is it's a small number of folks who keep cycling through, right? That's sort of the what usually happens in local jails, and especially for those folks, making sure there's something set up. And that might be something like a second look program to be like, how do we get you quickly out of here because this is no good for you, and how do we figure out something different?
I'm going to just off the top of my head, because you did that figure, it was basically that three-quarters of the people who go into the jail are there for their only time in their life.
Yep.
And this is looking back over 10 to 12 years, and then the about 5,000 people over that 10-year period accounted for 75%
of
the jail entries.
Yep.
So
breaking the cycle was the...
Yeah.
Yes. And you're talking about having been looking at those numbers, you're talking about families. I mean, you're talking about a father that I represent, and now a son, and now a grandson over the course of 40 years.
If I could just, and this was the one thing, I sat on that committee and did the data. The thing that struck me is how small the criminal population of Greene County is, that we literally, a couple of people can track them, all those people, and it was under 5,000, basically, that have ever been in repeatedly in jail.
Yep.
And if we kept an eye on them, and if we provided the kind of services you're talking about, they would be in and out, and in and out, and in and out, and in and out, which is what's running up all the bills. It's why you need all the officers. It's why you need all the beds.
Yep.
But a lot of what you described is the non-adversarial work, and that's what we don't have.
Yep.
We really don't have that, and so they're only seeing people who have a motive to have the problem be a client. And that needs to change before any architecture is changed.
Yeah. Well, let me just share something that New York City did, which when they started to do this, everybody thought this is the craziest idea ever. And what it is that the city actually took the rolls of admissions from Department of Homeless Services, from the emergency rooms, and from the jail, and they cross-matched to say, who are the 400 people who have touched the emergency room, the jail, and the homeless shelter like this many times in a certain, number of years? And they could literally create that list. And what they did was they hired caseworkers, and they went and found those people. So the next time they got arrested, the next time they showed up at the emergency room, there was literally a little alert for them. They said, we have a bed for you. Literally, they had housing, supportive housing, and it's here for you. You don't have to take it, but if you want it, here it is. And we will have a case manager for you. We will make sure we're here for you. If you get locked up again, we'll keep your apartment for 6 months. And the truth is, New York City could do it because New York City has so much in the way of resources, and I recognize that as I'm saying that to you all. But even if you thought about piloting that, it wouldn't cost that much to do that, even just for 5 or 10 apartments and one case manager. You could actually do the same thing here, and it might get to some of those folks, the frequent flyers that you see here in the jail.
Out of curiosity, because I've seen this frequent flyer kind of research, obviously, did the city do any kind of cost analysis? Because when you start to calculate the social services costs, the hospital costs, the jail costs, the whatever costs, and then...
So here's what it costs a year in New York City, which is more expensive real estate than, even though Greene County is beautiful, I'd move up here in a heartbeat. It's gorgeous. It was so nice to drive up today. But so in New York City, it costs about $25,000 a year per person who they sort of went and found in this way, compared to jail in New York City, which is $247,000 a year per bed. You all are not that expensive, but you all do run somewhere about $60 a day. Is it more?
It's way more.
We're over $300 a day.
Yeah, over $300 a day.
We have.
Wow.
Based on the budget and the population.
334.
Hey, we're a high-rent district.
You are a high-rent district. I promise you, this will be cheaper.
We have a lot of redundancy of services.
I mean, there is no universe in which it will be more expensive to do that, to sort of go divert people, than it will be to incarcerate them. I say this all the time, which is jail is the most expensive resource you have in your criminal justice system, so use it only for the cases where there really is no other option, because it literally is the most expensive resource you have. Doesn't mean it shouldn't be used, but it should be used judiciously.
Have you seen any impact by raising the age, removing 16-year-olds this year and 17-year-olds next year? Have you seen any impact?
So nobody's actually removed them yet. The deadline for meeting the raise the age requirements is October 1st, 2018 to get 16-year-olds out of adult jails and October 1st, 2019 for 17-year-olds. So we haven't quite seen that yet.
Okay. Have you done models to see what the impact's going to be?
In terms of cost?
In terms of raw numbers, just, you know.
I know that, who's handling that upstate? I'm trying to think of who is. I know we're doing it in New York City. I haven't followed it closely enough. If you're curious, I can ask around and find out.
I'm just wondering how it might affect our population, because that kind of larceny, property crime.
Yeah.
You know, somebody who has to, and gets thrown in jail for $250 on bail.
Yep.
Spends 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 days there. And might be 17 years old.
My sense is of your jail population, it tends to be older than the 16, 17-year-olds. It's actually, I don't remember the numbers, but it's something like 30 is the average age, something in the 30s.
Yeah, average age is 40, minimum age is 16, and 67% are under the age of 35. It doesn't give you a percentage.
We kind of guesstimated, and it looked like there were like 30 to 50% of 16 to 17 years, but that was a guesstimate.
That was a guesstimate that Jenna did. 30% of your jail is under.
It had been 16 to 17 year olds. It looked like at one point that was like an average.
That would shock me.
I could have been wrong. I'm so sorry. I apologize.
No, not at all. Because the jails that I've looked at around the state, so New York City is, we barely incarcerate 16 and 17 year olds, considering how many 16 and 17 year olds get arrested. But in other places that I think look a little bit more like Greene County, mm-hmm. it's still well under 10%
of
the jail population tend to be 16 and 17 year olds. 18 year olds, different story. 18 to 24 is actually where you see most of the activity happening, shall we say.
Probably have to start wrapping things up, but just want to make a point slash question, I guess, to this issue, because your point about the jail being your most expensive criminal justice resource locally, obviously we're at this moment in time where we have to make a decision about construction, and then the utilization of that resource is one thing, mm-hmm. but the decision to build or not is another, and I think that these issues related to raise the age and bail reform, which mm-hmm. is sort of on, on the horizon and likely inevitable, and what, in fact, that could likely look like in terms of a model and how that would reduce the Greene County population already without taking these additional steps, and what that is really going to look like, because right now is the moment in time where we make a decision to build or not to build, and if to build, how big. And so the utilization of the service later doesn't change the capital construction at this point. So any assistance or thinking about the impact of those things?
What Lori's referring to is Raise the Age was passed almost 2 years ago now, or a year and a half ago. Which gets 16 and 17-year-olds out of adult jails and into youth facilities or not incarcerated at all. And then bail reform has been perhaps the hottest criminal justice topic in Albany this past year. The Assembly passed a bill that the State Senate actually appeared to at least consider, and I think I would not be the least bit surprised, and again, bail is my bailiwick, that's what I do all day, every day. I wouldn't be surprised if we see some legislation pass in 2019 or 2020. And I think at minimum, what we will see is that the majority of misdemeanors that are currently going to jail across New York State will no longer go to jail. There might actually be movement with nonviolent felony offenses as well, but certainly with misdemeanors. And so in Greene County, I haven't seen great numbers for what percentage are misdemeanor. I haven't seen that publicly. But at least in the numbers that we crunched at VERA, which is again, federal data, it's not county data. County data is much better, so go with it if you have it. But it looks like the Greene County Jail is at least a quarter
Misdemeanors, probably higher, honestly. So you know that if bail reform passes, which I am pretty sure it will in the next couple of years, you're going to downsize your jail population by at least a quarter. There are parts of New York State and counties that will literally see their jail populations drop by over a half. Clinton County, which is all the way up north, right by Canada, 89% of its jail are people in on misdemeanors. Like, wow. You can just imagine the drop that will happen there. So know that that is really important to consider. It's another reason to think about what can we do differently before taking a really important step forward in construction, because there's a lot coming down the pike that might really influence how big the size of your jail, or how big sort of the size of like incarceration in Greene County, whatever form that looks like, should be. Lori, does that answer
it? Absolutely does. Thank you.
Thank
you very much.
Thank you all. Really appreciate it.
And how will the other candidates? Yes, the comments quick. July, August, and October, yeah. And all the other candidates except for Beals have said congratulations on the count. You know, it's very disappointing.
No, he was a wonderful, so it's a big thing.